What's up, everyone? It's your boy Lil Payton, and today we're going to be reviewing a new pair of clippers that I just ordered off of Amazon called Pamkers. You know, I heard good things about these or whatever. I like the color. I seen it was a YouTuber, I forgot the name of, you know, since I started off being a barber and shit. You know, and I've been looking at a few reviews, and there's this one specific barber who's been recommending these from a few YouTube.
Hey, man. What you doing? What you doing?
What are you doing?
What's doing?
What are you doing?
Get out of my chair. This ain't your channel. Get out of my chair. Get out of my chair.
Hey, Lil Payton, YouTube.
YouTube. What's up? It's Split Your Wig, aka Sour the Barber, not Lil Payton, back with another video. YouTube, guess who it is? It's your favorite YouTube barber. Split Your Wig from Network Barbershop. And as you can tell by my attire, I'm pressed for content. I'm getting a lot of footage in today. So, in my latest, greatest attempt to cheat the system, what we are going to do is a review and a tutorial on these no-name brand clippers that I got on eBay. Yes, the unboxing was shot today, and I'm also shooting this today. And you're probably thinking, couldn't that be one video? No, it can't, because I need more content. So this is gonna be a completely separate video, albeit shot the same day. And real quick, before we get into that, I just wanna give a quick shout out to MartyBlendz, because I saw his video for the $100 barber kit, and this was like $45, clipper and trimmer combo. And I was watching the video for just pure entertainment, right? But when he finally did his cut with the clippers, he had a lot of positive things to say about them. And I was like, man, could they really be that good? Could they really be on par or comparable to a mainstream, reputable clipper brand? And so it made me curious to try them out. So I literally ordered them the same day. They got here in 2 days, and we're gonna put them to work. Y'all stay tuned as we do a review and tutorial of tutorial of a tapered fro. I'm gonna call this one a Webbie. I'm from Louisiana, so we can call this a tapered Webbie. And let's get into this review / tutorial of these cheap, no-name brand, Pamker, whatever, clipper and trimmer combo for $45 on Amazon. Let's go!
Okay, so like always, the first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna start with our scalp analysis, combing through the hair, getting the hair prepped for the cut, making sure that the hair passed through the teeth of the blades easily. And apparently the second thing you're gonna wanna do is pump up your chest some more, because you realize you didn't pump it up enough the first time. And then you're gonna resume your scalp analysis. Next, we're going to use the Pamker trimmer to set in our first ball line at the temple. This is going to be a high temple taper, so he's not going to have a C arch in his hair, and we're going to clean up all the hair under that first ball line. course, after that, we're going to repeat the same process on the other side. Comb through the hair real good, get the hair nice and straight to pass through the teeth of the blades. And we're going to set in that same exact guideline on the other side of the temple in the same exact space, making sure it's even with the other side. And of course, we're going to clean up the bulk underneath and get it ready for the blend. Now at this point, I'm really surprised at how well these trimmers are handling the bulk removal. They're definitely exceeding expectations at this point. All right, we're moving on to the nape of the neck. Gonna set in the skin line for the nape of the neck so we can get that ready to blend together as well, since this is a high taper with the back neck taper as well. Next, we're gonna come in with the Pamker clipper all the way open, and we're gonna set our next guideline. This is gonna be our first guideline after the skin line. And what I'm noticing at this point, even though the clippers have a nice bit of sound to them, indicating like really good power, you'll probably notice that I am using more strokes to clean the panels out than I would be using if I were using, let's say, a Babyliss Low Pro or Stylecraft Rebel or Andy's Master. But it's still getting the job done. Right here I have the blade closed. And keep in mind, this clipper only has four levers instead of five. So there's no true midway. So you're definitely gonna have to play with the lever and do some trigger play to kind of get it consistent as you want it, because there's no true midway with this clipper. It has a click lever, so when you locked in the position, you just locked in that position. Now, as you can see, I'm struggling to get this guard on. Even though the guard feels pretty sturdy, it was kind of a hassle to get on, but be that as it may, we're gonna go in with the number two guard closed, and we are going to attack the top of the taper area. Gonna work into that fro, and we're gonna get it to where we can start blending the fro into the bottom level of the fade. And as you can see, I'm doing a lot of trigger play to get the lever just right so I can get the blend consistent because there's no midway. Right here, I'm going in with the number one guard all the way open, and I'm opening the blend up some more. I'm trying to get this panel as flush and clean as I can, even though the line is pretty much worked out at this point. Like, it's really doing what it's supposed to do, and I give it its props for that. I'm having to take a few more strokes than I'm used to, but by no means is it super noticeable or super inconvenient. It's getting some really clean panels, and it's really working these lines out. I was really surprised by that. And again, gotta use that trigger play to, you know, really get the blend tight, because I can't stress this enough. There is no midway level. Next, I'm coming back in with no guard all the way open, and I'm just doing some fine tuning and spot mopping just to make sure the blend is as clean as I can possibly get it. This is just detail work. Some people do it at the end of the cut, but since I was working on the side of the head and kind of reduced some of the unnecessary spinning, I figured I'd go ahead and knock it out now. And again, doing more trigger play, closing to attack the bottom parts of the blend and opening toward the higher parts of the blend. Next, I'm coming in with the three guard closed, and I'm going to work out the very most top part of the fade where the fro is meeting the rest of the blend. Now I'm coming back in with the one guard all the way open, and I'm essentially doing some more spot mopping and detail work, but just in a higher region of the fro where there's more bulk. So in a lower level, I can get away with using no guard all the way open, but in the higher levels, when you're dealing with more hair, you're gonna want some kind of guard on there, and I feel like the number one was the best one to use in this situation. And as you can see, I'm closing the clipper to work out some detail work toward the bottom. Next, I'm coming in the nape of the neck with my Pamker clipper all the way open with no guard, and I'm setting in my first panel, my first guideline after the skin line, about an inch long, and I'm combing it to make sure all the hair falls off, making sure everything is nice and consistent. I want the panel clean as possible. Now I'm closing up the clipper, no guard, working out that bottom line, and in between the two, I'm definitely gonna have to do some trigger play, because again, I only have four levels to work with instead of five. So when I'm in the middle realm, I have to kind of be careful how I handle the blade, because there's no true midway. Next, I'm coming in with the two guard fully closed, and I'm going to work out into the bottom of the fro, and I'm using the flick out motion, because again, I don't want to take too much hair off. I want the fro to blend in to the neck fade real nice, real smooth. And that flick out motion is gonna help me keep that consistency without taking off too much bulk and bringing the fade up too high. But they're really working. Like, these Pamker clippers are really doing what they're supposed to do. They're debulking well. They're getting rid of these lines. Like I said, a couple extra strokes here and there. They're not really pulling anything or tugging at the hair, so that's good. Like I say, a lot of quality that you wouldn't expect from such an inexpensive piece of equipment. And now I'm gonna close up the blade and go with the grain so I can get this blend just a little tighter. Do a little extra debulking and get the fade exactly how we want. Next, I'm coming in with the one guard fully open, and I'm working into that bulk, creating another panel, still using the flick out motion. Don't want to go up too high, don't want to take off too much bulk, because I don't want to have to bring the fade up higher into the fro. So I'm being very careful, but luckily, because they're not super powerful and just overwhelming, long as I maintain my position, I don't have to worry about a whole lot of hair coming off at once. Now I'm closing up the number one guard, and I'm working toward the bottom of that number one panel. Now right here, it's softening the line. It's not completely getting rid of it, but we got something for that. We're gonna come back and get rid of the line. But right now, it's doing its job just by softening the line up, getting it poised to be taken out easier later on. Right here, I'm doing some trigger play with the lever, just detailing, spot mopping, using a lot of my corners to make sure I'm not using too many teeth on the blade and cutting off more than I need to. Coming back in with the number three guard closed, and I'm just smoothing out that bulk area and getting it to a nice, consistent finish for the neck taper. say the guards felt so sturdy, I gotta be honest, these guards weren't exactly a joy to use. But I did eventually use these clippers with the dub guards, but that's a whole nother haircut. We'll talk about that later. Okay, next I'm coming back in, no guard, all the way open, free hand, using my corners and my comb to detail, catch any dark spots, work out any details that are catching my eye, that are keeping this fade from being as clean as it can possibly be. And so far I gotta say we're not looking too shabby to say this is a $45 combo. Okay, next I'm taking the Pamker clipper all the way open and I'm touching up the area behind the ear. You can't really see it too well, but there was like a little piece of bulk that was really dark and I wanted to clean it up because it was just obviously dark and it was keeping the fade from coming together entirely. And I'm gonna repeat that same process on the left side of the head. Pull the ear back, leave the clipper all the way open, and you're just gonna use the corners to attack just that area so that detail can be accounted for. A more trigger play and detail work just to make sure everything is as consistent as it should be. Now I'm going to close the blade on my Pamker clipper and I'm gonna freehand shape the fro just by hovering it over my client's head and just getting off the wild hairs, maybe just like a very thin, insignificant amount of the fro because I want it to be clean, I want it to be neat. I don't want any stragglers, I want it to be round and even. I will say the Pamker clipper did handle shaping the fro pretty well. I didn't have to go over things too many times. It was a fairly easy and intuitive process. You know, you're just hovering over the head, maintaining the shape, just going along as you do. This process wouldn't have been any easier if I had used any of my other big budget clippers. Like, it handled the shaping of the fro very well. Gotta be detailed when shaping up that fro. Next, I'm coming back with the Pamker trimmer, the same ones we use to set in our guideline. And I'm just gonna tap lightly at the neckline to edge up the nape of the neck area to finish out this part of the haircut. Not applying a whole lot of pressure. Just letting the blade do all the work. And then I flip the trimmer upside down to clean up the residual hair that's left behind under the lining area. And we're gonna pull the ear down, use the corner of our blade to get that arch around the ear just right. Just because it's not super noticeable doesn't mean we don't put our maximum effort into getting the curves behind the ear just right. Gotta have it lined up just right. Same thing on this side, we're just repeating the process, tapping lightly at the nape of the neck area, and we're gonna close out the neck fade by just lining it up real cleanly. And we're gonna flip the trimmer upside down, clean up the residual hair. And of course, after this, it's cleaning up behind the ear. Use comb to get that stubborn hair that was cut and just hanging around. Hold the ear down and take your time going around the arch of the ear. You know, you want it to be consistent. You don't want it to be misshapen. You know, you want to be real consistent with your movement. And here we're gonna do the forehead lining. I didn't use any hole spray or any type of enhancer yet. I did eventually enhance the cut, but I wanted to get through the cut as natural as possible with using just these tools. No enhancements, no hole sprays, no other equipment. So I want you guys to be able to see what the natural version of this haircut looks like. So just gonna comb it down, start tapping at the forehead from the center with the Pamker trimmer and following the standard protocol for doing the forehead liner. Now these trimmers aren't super sharp. That doesn't necessarily mean they're dull either. My client described them as being very smooth on the skin, not abrasive at all. They didn't get hot, they didn't scratch anything. But with that, they were set close, so they were able to leave a fairly sharp line, but it did take, you know, some effort to make that happen. On this side, we're just going to continue the same thing. Start from the center, work our way outward on the forehead line until we get to the vertical bars, and then line that up. At this point, we pretty much all know the protocol. And here is the natural version of the cut. Only the Pamker equipment used at this point. No hole sprays, no enhancers, no GMOs, just a completely organic cut. This is the finished product. Semi-finished because the enhancement is coming. Okay, so at this point, I've already went ahead and used the Kiss Effix Darkest Brown to color the line, and the Barber Magic pencil. I used the white pencil on this client because he has a lighter skin tone, so the tan pencil wouldn't really, you know, not gonna show up on their skin tone. So you always wanna go one shade down from your client. And I'm using these Pamker trimmers to blend the magic pencil in. And this is the enhanced version of the cut.
All right, YouTube, and that's the cut. Few final notes on our clipper trimmer combo. Let me see, what are the pros of this clipper? The pros, first of all, are the price. $45 for a clipper and a trimmer. that basically means this is $25, this is $20, if you want to break it down with something else. So that's the first pro. Another pro is it came with a comb, some oil, and some guards and stuff. Like, it came with a lot of accessories to say it was so expensive. Another pro, they actually perform really well. By comparison, I remember a couple of years ago when everybody on YouTube was doing like the Walmart clipper challenge, and everybody had to go get a cheap ass clipper from Walmart to see if they could still do a good cut. These are better than Walmart clippers, and they're about the same price as Walmart clippers, maybe even cheaper than Walmart clippers, and they're way better than the home version of the big brand clipper. To be honest, it's kind of amazing, like, this trimmer exists, and yet the G-Wiz from Wall was so lackluster. Like, if this can exist, I know we can get a G-Wiz or a cordless hero that's like, that has a lithium-ion battery in it that can do some stuff. As far as the clipper goes, like I said, it cuts real well, it blends real well. One of the things that kind of caught me off guard is the lever. It only has four positions instead of five. That's a little odd, but we were still able to make it do what it do. The battery indicator was very helpful, especially because there's not a lot of specs on here about the clipper. By the time I finished the cut, I tapered both sides and the neck and shaped up the Afro. I was down to exactly 70%, which means I used 30% through the cut, which means I could probably get about three or four good cuts out of this clipper before it died. And truthfully, even with these big brand clippers, that have these super exaggerated runtime, that's probably about what you're gonna get out of those without, you know, sitting it on the charge station in between. So 30% for one haircut, I don't have no complaints. I really thought that was gonna be the weak point of this clipper because I just can't wrap my mind around how good this performed for $45. Let me see what else was there about the clipper. The guards absolutely worth it. Glad they came with them. And even though I said they feel more premium in hand than like wall factories, they were such a struggle and a burden to get on the clipper that they came with. Side note, for those who are wondering, I did try the wall premium clippers on there. They fit like a champ. I tried the Barberless standard guards because I don't have any Barberless premium guards. They fit like a champ. But what surprised me most of all was I put the Stylecraft Dubs on here. And I didn't cut with them, but I just, you know, and the fit was perfect. I really can't wait to do that next. I want to cut with these with the Stylecraft Dove guards and see if it makes a difference in the experience. Because number one, those are my favorite guards. And even when I put those guards on the Fabulous Low Pro, they fit, but there's just a slight insignificant wiggle. This has no wiggle. Like, it fits like a glove. It's amazing. And there's really just not a whole lot more to say about it. Earlier I said the clipper was metal. That's because it looks metal. So in my brain keeps registering this product as metal, but it doesn't feel metal in my hand. So it has a very conflicting, it feels very weird when I'm using it. I'm pretty sure in time I'll get used to it, but that was another thing. So call that a pro or con if you want. As for the trimmer, it's not a whole lot to say about it. It does exactly what it's supposed to. Are there other trimmers out there that hit harder? Of course there are. But are there any trimmers that cost roughly $20 that can do what these do? Not even close from what I've seen. They don't make a trimmer that can do what these do for the price. And the best way to sum up this whole combo is this. The price to quality ratio is wildly disproportionate in favor of this combo. And what I mean by that is, to say we have, like, let's say, I'm gonna use my Ant's Master cordless, for example, that I paid about $250 plus tax for, that's like at least five times more than what these are, right? But are they five times better than these? No. And this ain't a stab at the Masters. What I'm saying is, these perform way better than something this price should perform. Are these going to be a workhorse? Not for me, you know. These aren't going to be like a major staple. But do they have a place in my arsenal? Yes. I can really see myself using these for blending in kids and just doing little simple haircuts and the trimmers. My nephew, when I did his cut, he said that the trimmers felt real smooth. They didn't pinch at all, but they left really nice, sharp, consistent lines. Again, was it the best? No, but did it work? It exceeded every expectation, which is saying a lot, because what would you expect from $20 trimmers? So ultimately, do I recommend these? I really do. For $45, you just can't go wrong. And like I said, worst case scenario, I get an unboxing video, a review video, and maybe even a giveaway video out of it. Worst case scenario, and then I only lose $45. I'm good with that. Best case scenario, they make it into the lineup. And even though I have a pretty nice station, which my What's At Your Station video is going to be coming soon, these very much have a place in my station. And if you have an extra $45 to spare, I think they have a place in yours too. But don't take my word for it. Get on Amazon, give them a try. And once again, shout out to Marty Blendz for inspiring me to try these, because it's like Christmas came early, man. These are probably going to be like my new favorite toys, at least for a little while, until something else bigger and bright and shiny comes out. And I go spend all my money on that. So that's it for this review / tutorial. If you liked the video or found it helpful in any kind of way, please like and comment. Tell me why you like it. And then subscribe, and then comment again and tell me that you subscribe. And then comment again just to say, hey, I commented. And also comment one more time after that. And don't forget to share and do all the fancy YouTube stuff that I normally get to say at the end of these videos. Am I leaving anything out? Nope, that's pretty much it. So until the next video, thank you guys for tuning in. Thank y'all for supporting the channel. And I don't know what the next video is going to be, probably What's At Your Station. But yeah, we'll be back next time from Network's Barbershop. I am Split Your Wig, Sidewalk the Barber, and I'm out.